So welcome to another session of the Microsoft Virtual Academy. This time we're talking about creating complex workflows with System Center 2012 SP1 Orchestrator. My name is Andreas Reins. I'm a data center architect at Microsoft, and this is the objectives for today. So I would like to give you a quick overview about some foundation objects that are commonly used in complex workflows when you deal with Orchestrator. So I would like to give you some sort of understanding how to create those complex workflows and how to work with those foundation objects and how to make it real in your runbooks. So the agenda for today looks like this. So first of all, I'd like to talk about how to query WMI. So this is one activity within the foundation objects of Orchestrator. Then I'd like to talk about how to call or invoke web services within your runbooks. And then the third one is how to work with XML files and XML results. So this works pretty much together with the web service activity. But we'll see that in a second. Then I'd like to talk a little bit about how to work with databases and how to query databases within your runbooks. Then there are two activities that are quite interesting. First of all is how to run programs and commands, and then how to run .NET scripts. So there are a couple of different options here, and this is one of the powerful activities within Orchestrator. And last but not least, I'd like to show you how to call or how to set up an SSH connection and how to work with that in Orchestrator. So starting with query WMI. So this activity will actually just send a WMI query to a system that you're able to specify. So if you see the screenshot on the bottom, that's pretty much that you have to define. First of all, which is the computer you'd like to talk to, then the namespace, and then you're just entering the WMI query. And this really gives you the output on the data bus. So whatever that WMI query will return, this data will be published to the data bus. So there are a couple of items that will be published. So the computer where the WMI query is performed, the WMI query itself will be published on the data bus, and of course the query result of the WMI query will be published as a string to the database as well, plus the namespace will be there as well. So after using that activity within your runbook, you can grab those result and the namespace and the computer and the query from the database and work with that from there. So that's pretty much it about the WMI activity, but pretty powerful, but of course less flexible than the .NET script objects that we are going to tackle in a few slides. So the next one, which is also quite interesting, is how to work with web services. So there is one activity that's called invoke web service, and that invoke web service really runs a web service and give you the options to define XML parameters and give you also, of course, the result as an XML. So in the screenshot on the right, you see that you have to define the WSDL file, which is actually the description file of the web service. So whenever you go out to the web and check out for some available web services, so there is always a weather web service available for free just to work and test with that. So you can use that one, and then you just have to define the WSDL URL in the first text box. The next one is the method. So your web service that you're going to use might have a different or multiple methods. In this case, we have one method called get cities by country, which just gives you a list of cities by a specified country. And then you have to define the XML request payload. And there is this button format hint on the very bottom of that window, which helps you or which gives you hints on how to format the XML job payload. So that's actually the input for the web service method that you specified above. So with that activity, we will support SOAP 1.1 and 1.2, and the result will be published on the database again. And this is an XML document that you can then parse with XPath queries using the next activity that's called Query XML. So that's more or less it. Of course, you can also define how to use authentication, HTTP authentication, in the advanced tab of that window on the right. So you can define a username, you can define passwords, and another option is to use HTTPS certificates, but that's not part of that window, but there is in the designer, there is the option menu where you are able to define HTTPS certificates in there. So the next one is actually Query XML activity. That's the one that you probably will use if you're going to work with web services, because you, in one way or the other, you would like to work with the result set of that web service. But of course, you can also use an XML file that you grab from the file system or somewhere else. So actually, you have in that window on the right, you see you either define the XML file, or you just define the block of XML, which might be the published data from the invoke web service that happens before that activity. So, the most important part is the XPath query. So if you're not familiar with XPath, that's a pretty powerful language to parse XML files and to grab data out there. So either elements, attributes, and you can define filters there. And it's a pretty powerful language, XPath. So you find a couple of information how to work with that online, but there you define the XPath query, and the result set or the result from that will be published on the database again. So if you run that activity, if you go to the database, you will have the query result published there, XML attributes published there. You will have the XPath query itself published to the database, and also the node count. So if you are looking for example, for an element called temperature, and there are a couple of elements there that are called temperature, you will also get the count of the nodes or the elements in the database, as well as a published variable there as well. So the next one is actually its query database activity. So with that, it really does what it says. You're able to query a database table, and we are going to support the following databases: Microsoft Access. You can define ODBCs, and you can use SQL Server, of course, and Oracle databases. So with that, you define your connection string. You're able to define your authentication method. So either for SQL Server, for example, you're able to define if you're going to use Windows authentication or SQL Server authentication. And then you define your query the way you would do it in a standard SQL tool to query database tables. So, and the result set will be the rows. The resulting rows will be published to the database again. So, and the fields are returned in semicolon format. And then, of course, you can use those manipulation functions that I showed you in another session before that, how to work with strings. So another one is actually the run program activity. And the run program activity gives you the option to run any program or any command on a specified computer. and in your domain, and you can either do that in an interactive mode or in a background mode. And so, for example, you can run a batch script with that, or even a set of complex commands, for example. So the way you're going to configure that activity is pretty simple. So you either define if it's a command line you would like to run, or if it's a program you would like to run. And of course, you need to define the computer, the target computer, and you also have to define which user account will run that program or the command. So that's the important part. That user account needs to have admin rights and permissions on that target computer to run that program. So that's the important part. And of course, you also have to think about, should it be an interactive mode? So should there be an interaction with the user in front of that computer, or should it run in the background mode without any interaction with a user? So if you're going to use the program execution mode, you just are able to grab that executable from your file system, or you're using the command execution set, then you just use it the same way as you're using a Windows command prompt. Then you define the computer, and then there is also a program path you have to define where the command or the program is located. You're defining your parameters, of course, that you would like to pass in, and you can, of course, use published data and published variables there as well. So one more thing you have to define, which is actually on a separate tab called Advanced, is the execution mode. So again, there are three different options for the execution mode. First of all, it's interactive. So if you want to display a user interface to a given user on that target computer, you have to choose interactive. The other way is to run that program or command in the background, and there are two options there, normal and low priority, but in both ways you won't have an user interface that really runs in the background, and the process priority is set to what you specified, so either low or normal. What I want to mention here is that also that you're able to set the wait for completion of that activity and that program. So you can define if that activity should wait if that program or command is finished. For the interactive mode, that happens only if the user closes the program. For the background mode, it really waits if that program or command is completed. And of course, you can also set a timeout here, so a terminate after X minutes. Then it will wait and terminate that program if it's not finished by that time. And of course, you can specify a username and a password for authentication, and that's important to know for interactive mode. It will open that session or that interactive command prompt in that user session that you specified in the username. So that's important to know. And of course, published data is used here as well. So after that activity runs, there is a couple of data that will be published to the data bus. Of course, it's the parameters, the path, the process ID, the output of that program, of course, the exit code, which are the two most important ones, of course. Then an unmodified output of the program will be published to the data bus as well, and a couple of other variables will be published as well. So probably the most powerful activity within the foundation objects is the run .NET scripting activity. So with that, you're able to run scripts, and those scripts can be written actually in VB.NET, in JScript, and C#, or even Windows PowerShell. So those are the options that you have with that activity. We are actually supporting the .NET CLR version 2.0 and later. And so that's a pretty powerful activity where you can really work with scripts, with parsing data, with APIs, with .NET APIs, and a lot of things can be done here. For example, if you want to work with PowerShell commandlets, I mean, if you think about all the Microsoft products, they have support for a lot of commandlets, and System Center, for example, has tons of commandlets where you can really do almost everything with PowerShell, and you're now able to work with that within Orchestrator, within your workflows. So what you have to think about when you start using the run.NET scripting activities, first of all, the code that you want to run, and then, of course, which libraries or namespaces you'd like to use in that script, and the data you want to publish. From a security perspective, it's important to understand that the user account that's defined as the runbook service account will be used for that, for the security credentials for that script. So whenever that script runs against another computer, the runbook service account will be used for authentication, and it has to have access to the resources and to those stuff you are going to do with your script. So from a configuration perspective, it's pretty much easy. It's just two things that you have to define on the first tab. It's either it's the type, so it's either a VP.NET, JScript, C# or Windows PowerShell, and then it's just a big box for your script. And then there is another tab where you have to define namespaces. So in case you would like to use some .NET namespaces and you don't want to have a fully qualified name with every object and every method you're going to call from that namespace, you have to define those namespaces there. And you can also define the references there as well to assemblies that you're going to use in your script. So and then you're almost done. You just have to define the publish data, and those are either date time integer or string types or collections. So if your data is some multi-value data, then you define collections as you publish data, and you give those published data a name, and then of course you also have to give them a variable name, which then automatically create a .NET property for those items, and then you're going to assign the values to those .NET properties, and then this will be published to the database at the end. So actually that's it about the .NET scripting, and it's a very powerful way to work with different systems, different tools. So you can really run all your commandlets, PowerShell commandlets you can think of. You can work with .NET APIs. You can use your JScript stuff. Everything that would work with your runbooks now with that run.NET scripting activity. So last but not least, it's the run SSH command activity. Actually, it really again does what it says. It opens an SSH connection to a remote server that you specify in the computer text box, and then it really runs shell commands here. And we're supporting not only commands but also command set files. You can specify also the port that's going to be used, a timeout, connection timeout in seconds, and also the character set can be defined here as well. And of course, we're also supporting username and passwords and passphrases for authentication here as well, plus key files. So this is another activity that's part of the foundation objects of Orchestrator 2012, which you can use to create your complex workflows.